All right, good morning, everyone. Can we find our seats and tune in? How are we doing today?
Good.
If you're new here, welcome. We're glad that you're here. You can find any information you need about our church on our website. So certainly plug in there if you're new. But if you have questions directly, please feel free to ask me. I'm Pastor Ryan. You can talk to anybody that you would see in there. Tiffany's back there in the booth. Pastor Don's over here. Pastor Jim and Tony, where are they all at? Okay, if you're new here, what I'm getting at is I want you to connect with somebody. Ask questions. We'd love to tell you more about our church. But one thing you will know from the get-go is we love worship. We love to praise God. And we stand on the truth of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Today's going to be, I'm going to give a little bit longer intro to today. Today, I've been thinking a lot about direction and vision and just the calling on our lives in Christ in this unique time period that we live in. I mean, every time period's unique. But there are some unique challenges that we face today. And who are we as a church? So I want you to think about that. Who are we as a church? What's our mission besides what we put down in fancy form on paper? What are we really trying to do? Why are we here? So I want you to think about that and just kind of take a minute. Think about who you are and how God has uniquely wired you, uniquely created you, uniquely gifted you. And then why here? What brought you here? What does it mean to be part of a community of faith? What does it mean to be part of the body of Christ? That's a biblical term. What does it even mean? And then I want us to worship from a place that's very deep in our heart, with the understanding that the Lord might show us things about ourselves today, even as we worship. He might show us things about ourselves personally, areas we need to grow, areas that we have grown that we can celebrate. He might show us things about who we are collectively, together. And I pray for great vision and the spirit of revival to come out today. Amen. So with that being said,
yes.
Eric, are you going to bless us with a call to worship? Because I'm going to ask that we stand for it.
Absolutely. Good morning, Red Oak Church. Welcome. Call to worship this morning is taken from Psalm 49:13. Isaiah. Sing for joy, O heavens, and exalt, O earth.
Break forth, O mountains, into singing.
For the Lord has comforted his people and will have compassion on his afflicted.
Sing for joy, O heavens, and exalt, O earth. Sing with us. Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my hands the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee. Ready, my God, thy will. Silent. Lord, open our eyes and our ears and our mouth as we testify to the life that we have in you. I've been wondering, everywhere I look, people are putting forth an image. Businesses putting forth an image. People putting forth an image. Social media, a platform to put forth an image. Commercials. Putting forth an image. And I guess what's been deep in my heart is, what's the mask and what's real? And how do we strip away what isn't real, what isn't authentic, what isn't genuine, and get to the heart of true, authentic life? And that's what I've been wrestling with. That's what I was thinking about during this last week and taking a kind of professional development week, and I've been wrestling with, who am I as a pastor? Who are we as a congregation? Who are you as a child of God? And what's the image that is constantly being sold to us? Lord, strip the masks away.
This world starts breaking me down. I get so lost, I think I'll never be found. And there were moments of fear and doubt, even the best fall to the ground. I am a mess,
I am a wrecking ball. I must confess that I still don't get it all.
Lord,
I press on,
I press on.
I love this next song. What does it mean for God to be our refuge and our strength? Famous verse in Scripture says it. I want you to think about your life right now. I want you to think about wherever you are and whatever you're going through. Because we all go through something, don't we? Anybody here got it all figured out yet? Anybody here feel like life is just perfect? What does it mean to be our refuge and strength? What does it mean that God's that in your life? Refuge, a place to hunker down and feel secure. Context of refuge is usually used in battle. Who do you run to when life seems overwhelming? Is the Lord the first one you go to? Or is he last on the list after you've exhausted your other options? God is our refuge and strength, yes. A very present help in a time of trouble. Sing that with me. God is our refuge and strength, yes. A very present help in a time of trouble.
Thank you.
strength.
God is our refuge and our strength.
Very present help. This is easy words. Sing it with me. God is our refuge.
God is our refuge and our strength.
Sing it like you mean it. Come on. Very present help.
A very present help in times of trouble.
God is our refuge.
God is our refuge and our strength.
Very present help.
A very present help in times of trouble.
Very present help in times of trouble. Hallelujah. God, you are our refuge. Keep singing.
And our strength.
Sing it until it finds that place that deep in your heart you need it. Let's sing to the glory of God. You are our refuge.
God is our refuge and our strength.
You know He is, you know it. Every present
help. Every present help in times of trouble.
God, you are our refuge.
God is our refuge and our strength.
Lord, be glorified in the song that we sing. When it comes from the heart. What will you do with us today, Lord? What mystery awaits us to be unveiled? What are you most grateful for today? Say it out. What are you most grateful for? Salvation.
My church family.
Church family. Amen. Amen. God be our refuge and our strength. Very present help. Present help. Right here. What are you grateful for? Spirit amongst us. God's church. His word. His presence. A very present help in times of trouble. Oh, wait. I thought when you come to Christ, there's no more trouble. Now what? Doesn't it say that somewhere? Not in the word, right? I haven't seen that anywhere in the word. What it says is, God, you are a present help. Your presence is here in times of trouble. Lord, be glorified in this moment when we sing from our heart. And all God's people say, amen. Please be seated.
Can I have you repeat after me before the offering? It is more blessed to give than to receive. It is more blessed to give than to receive. The heart of a Christian has been formed by grace, mercy, and forgiveness that we did not deserve. Amen? And now let us give to God and show our appreciation to the God who loves us more than we could even love ourselves. And all God's children said, amen. Ushers, please come forward. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. It is more blessed to give. It is more blessed to give. Thank you, O Lord, for giving us the greatest gift of life, Jesus Christ, his grace, his mercy, and the hope that we have in him. Add your blessings now to all those who have given in the name of Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. All God's thankful people rejoiced and said, amen. Amen.
Mike is good, T. Well, allergy season is in full swing. Anybody there? I am. I have not much of a voice today, but I do have a word, I believe, from God that he put on my heart. So the voice will carry through. Yes. I don't even know how much you really need to get into the outline today. I just want to speak to you from the heart about something that as I looked from the week I took a vacation in February during the kids' vacation week and went down to Virginia and Florida, and you heard that trip 2 weeks ago. It sounded like 50 hours of, whew, I felt like I was driving. I know, Rich, you're a truck driver. About 5 hours into that trip, I was thinking of you, saying, how does he do this? Right? But it's no joke, right? But listen, so then I had this last week, right, for professional development, where I just sat and percolated with what the Lord put on my heart. Oh, junior worship. I'm sorry. I am so excited to tell you what the Lord put on my heart, I forgot about junior worship. So, let's hear it for the kids. So, thank you for that. My head is still not here, right? It's funny we made a time just to remember the kids, because I'll be honest with you, that's a lot of what I've been thinking about is the next generation, too, and what they're being sold. And I'm going to be a little controversial today, and I'm certainly going to be off script. I'm worried about what they're being sold, not just from the world. I'm worried about what they're being sold about the gospel, too. I am, okay? And I need to talk about it, and so today is going to be more like a visionary type message, not just a standard sermon. I may take some different roads, and it may look like I'm preaching a little different than normal, and that's okay, right? I look not only to my children, right, who are now growing up, and I don't even know if I can say children anymore, but you're always my child, okay? And you're always your mother's baby, so just deal with it. You'll be 50 years old, you'll still be like, my babies. Some big babies right there. They don't make diapers in that size. Okay? they make them. He said they make them. I ain't touching that. I'm not going there. Bring this one back in. All right? So, I want to talk to you. I want to talk to you as a church. And I want to just speak from the heart today. Okay? I'm going to start the sermon, then go into our prayer that we do before the sermon, and then go back to the sermon. Tiffany, I want you to put up the first joyfully bliss picture. They're what? The other two, the last two. Nope, the joyfully bliss one. That's not the joyfully bliss one there, T. Apparently Tiffany's head is not here either. You just gave away, Tiffany. Tiffany just ruined this illustration. We love her anyways. Why don't you try the joyfully bliss one, T? You don't have it. Oh. You ruined my illustration. T, I'm going to do you an amazing favor right now, because actually the fact that this is bumpy right now is going to tie into what I have to say. Can you pull it up if I go into a prayer?
Yes.
I'm going to do the prayer first. I suddenly feel impressed from the Lord that we are meant to do the prayer first and the illustration second. So, and all God's people say,
amen.
Beautiful. Pastor Don, you want to bail us out and give us a prayer here? Let me give you, you've had a rough couple days. Is anybody's head here today that, no, here. I just took the microphone out, half the bottom came out. Oh, man. Tiffany, you're going to get extra time. Go ahead. Watch out for the battery. Don't zap yourself. Go ahead. Pray for us. Pray for us.
Oh, Lord, have mercy.
Have mercy.
Oh, Lord, have your compassion. We're kind of fumbling around here, Lord. We know you can straighten us out. So we say, Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, give Pastor Ryan the words to speak. Give us the ears to hear, and grant unto us additional steps on the way to abundant life, steps that you have prepared for us. Grant unto us, O Lord, your Spirit, that we may understand and that we may have the mind of Christ, as your word says. Be with Pastor Ryan. O Lord, if he would say anything that isn't what you're about or your will, strike it from our memory, strike it from our ears. But Lord, we know that our pastor is going to speak the truth. And we know that Jesus, you are the way and the truth and the life. So give him the way. because he has the truth, so that we may all have abundant life. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Tiff, do we have a joyfully bliss picture? Oh! Yeah. Tiff, there's nothing wrong with you that a good nap won't fix right now. Ah. Doesn't that look joyful?
Yes.
Is that a path you would want to travel?
Yes.
Does it look like people are enjoying the world? There's palm trees in the back.
Yes.
Florida, wherever it might be, okay? There's the picture you're being sold on every commercial about what life's all about. It's right there. There it is. That's the path that everybody wants to take, whether it's a Target commercial or a Best Buy. Somehow Best Buy will tell you that you could put a TV on that palm tree back there and skip around in abundant life. Now the next picture, you're gonna pretend you didn't see. Does that look like a fun path? Someone said yes. Listen, Rich, you're a big guy. I don't know about that third board right there, and you are gonna have some struggles. I'm gonna tell you that right now. Pastor Don's amen in it. Doesn't look like a fun path, does it?
No.
Not the picture that the world would sell you about life, right? About where to find it. All right. Well, Tiffany, I assure you we will come back to these pictures, so you might want to save them. Don't delete them. One looks like danger. One looks like comfort. Actually, go back for a minute, T. I'll have you on your toes today. I want you to look at that sign, danger, do not enter. Which path do you think the world tells you that sign belongs? On that one, right? You wouldn't look at the other path. Go back to the other one. And expect to see a danger, do not enter sign there, would you? So we've got some hard verses to wrestle through from Jesus. Because what Jesus says about where that sign might belong, danger, do not enter, is going to seem very contrary to what we are being sold, both in the world and too often in the church. Matthew 7:13. Enter by the narrow gate. For the gate is wide and the way is easy, fun, joyful, that leads to destruction. And those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life. And those who find it are few. The way that, turn that joyful picture back on, T. That's what the way of destruction is going to look like. It's going to disguise itself as that right there. And the way that leads to life is going to be hard. And the world's going to tell you the do not enter, warning, danger sign, belongs on the hard one. But Jesus says the opposite. Jesus says the way that I'm going to give you that leads to life is going to be hard, and not many people are going to go down that. There's going to be a lot of people standing on that do not enter sign saying, I'm not going down there. And then Jesus says this verse from John 12:25, which I have wrestled with this verse. I wrestled with this verse on my vacation. I wrestled with this verse in my professional development week, and it's all culminating to what I feel I have to say to you today as your pastor. It's a controversial scripture, and it's a hard scripture, but maybe the hard stuff is what leads to life, as Jesus said. John 12:25. Whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life.
How joyful does that sound? How fun does that sound? What does Jesus mean? I have wrestled with this verse throughout my life. I keep coming back to it saying, oh, Lord, I don't know what to make of this verse. There were times I was so low, I felt so despondent, I felt so dejected, I felt so, right? That I said, if that verse is true, then I must have eternal life. Because I'm not enjoying what's happening now. Maybe some of you have been there. And yet, we're supposed to have joy here. How does this work? How does this even make sense in our mind? And I think we must go back. I want to go back even before this verse to verse 24, because I think it's the verse that comes before that verse and the verse after that's going to shed some light here. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it. Whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Now, the master said what the master said. We got to wrestle with it. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. And where I am, there will my servants be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. Listen, if anyone serves me, he's going to have to walk where I walk and follow me. Jesus walked on some hard, rough bridges. People that wanted to follow him, right? We read in the New Testament, he said, be careful. Foxes have holes to live in, right? I didn't have anywhere to put my head. It's not going to look particularly comfortable for you. If you think that coming and following me means that life is going to be a bunch of roses, a frolic in the park with palm trees, and a comfortable bed to lay your head in, you will be sorely mistaken. Because the road that leads to life, oh, it's narrow. Few are going to find it, and it's a hard road. And so we get from this passage here in John, right, that something about losing your life, something about hating your life in this world is because you are longing, and this is the crux of what I want you to get today. You are longing so badly for new life. You are so tired of the phony image that's being sent that you're saying, I'm done with it. I'll walk the hard bridge if it's going to lead me to life. I'll walk the bridge that looks like it's going to crack if Jesus tells me that that's where he's going to be too. And until you are tired of the image that's being sold to us, both in the world and in the church, and I'll get to that before this sermon's done, okay? Until we recognize that real, true life has nothing to do with the rosy image we're being sold, until we grasp that, we are going to struggle not only physically, but spiritually. Spiritually, we're not going to understand the roads that we're walking. We're not going to understand where things are living, right? That word hate, when Jesus says you got to hate your life in this world in order to keep it for eternal life, that word hate in the original language that the Bible was written in, okay, means to have an aversion to be disinclined towards or to disfavor. There's a great switch that Jesus is suggesting to you, that Jesus is commanding to you, that Jesus is beckoning to you. You got to have an aversion to the gimmick that's being sold to you if you want to find what's authentic and real. You have to be disinclined to the life that's being sold to you because it isn't real. That's a hard word today, isn't it? Yeah. It's a hard word. There's a great switch. Have an aversion to the rosy picture and say, I'm willing to walk on the path that nobody else wants to walk on. Because Jesus tells me I'll find life there. And so I am looking today to share with you what I feel God has been impressing on me. I've been in this place, and it's funny. I didn't originally plan to go on vacation and have that moment that I shared with you a couple weeks ago, feeling very, all of a sudden, questioning, feeling loved, and all these things that popped up, and I just poured that out a couple weeks ago, and how God gives us signs in those moments, right? And when I planned a professional development week, I didn't expect that I would have this time to process what I just came out of. And what I feel the Lord is doing and what I feel like this moment is for is I want to tell you what I feel called to as a pastor. Not because the sermon's going to be about me. It's not. But you need to know where I'm coming from on the pulpit. And the vision that I see the Lord working in this church. I think it's important. I think it's essential. And I think every once in a while you got to have one of those down-home chats. Where are we going? What's the bridge look like? And what's the world and the picture that we are being sold? I believe what I have to say is going to speak directly to the power and the influence of the gospel in our lives. Good news in a land that doesn't always feel very good to us. Good news. If I was to summarize my calling as a pastor, what I feel the Lord has brought me through, what I feel called to deliver, is that there is good news in a land that doesn't always feel good. There is good news in a land that doesn't always feel good to us. I believe there's a calling, that's the calling that I feel as a pastor and as a preacher to get us prepared. I don't know where the Lord's going to bring us on this path, but I do believe that that's what I've been called to share. I gave you this message 2 weeks ago, right, before my professional development week. And I said, if you remember, I said there's two truths that drive this wedge in our life, and in many ways, this is going to piggyback off of that. Number one was the world is brutally difficult. You can put that rosy picture up, the rosy one, T, okay? Right? That's what's being sold, but that isn't the truth of what really is, and every one of us here knows it. And we get frustrated beyond belief because we can't seem to be skipping through the park. Because we're told that's where our happiness lies. We're told that's when we'll really all of a sudden put to bed all those dysfunctions that have been brewing around since childhood. We have that picture, we're going to finally feel loved. We have that picture, we're going to finally feel like we aren't rejected. We have that picture, we aren't going to be afraid anymore. We have that picture, we're going to be healthy. We have that picture, we're going to be wealthy. We have what the world is selling us, and we'll be skipping, as you like to say, doing those kippies throughout the field, right? That's what's being sold, and it isn't real. It isn't real because the world is difficult and the world is hard and every one of us knows it. And if you remember from 2 weeks ago, I said where that drives a real wedge in us is we have these very primitive emotional survival instincts, emotional and physical fight or flight instincts, and we begin to craft a way of dealing with the fact that the picture we're being sold and the way the world is don't match. And so we have all these insights to reject people before we get rejected, to never try so that we don't fail, to pretend that we're confident when we're afraid. We have all these ways to deal with it, and it begins to bring us down. It leads to depression. It leads to anxiety because I can't control what I'm trying to control. That was the premise from 2 weeks ago. And if you remember, the conclusion of it is we spend so much time trying to control the what's, the where's, and the how's of life. To take those details, what am I going to do with this? How am I going to get there? Where am I going? How can I protect myself from pain? Remember the pain management that we often use religion for, even. And I said, and what Jesus has been trying to tell us is it's not the what and the where and the how. It's the who you have to run to in all of this. We spend far too much time on the what's, the where's, and the how's and forget the who. Well, that was 2 weeks ago. I remember, now that I have a 16-year-old who was getting his license, car shopping. You ever come to the realization that the picture you see online looks nothing like the picture when you get there? And you think, how did this picture of this car look so good? And then I pop the hood open, I don't even think it has that engine. Because the picture you're being sold isn't real. It isn't real, and boy, are we doing that well. We are car shopping in every aspect of our lives. Everyone. Revelation 18 through 20, it's not going to be up on the screen, has this premise, this conclusion of the Bible, that the devil has deceived us, tricked us into thinking that if we control life, we will get that rosy picture. The Bible starts with the same premise. Did God really tell you you can't have that fruit? Don't you know you're going to be like him? All you got to do is do it your way. You control whether or not you look like God. Go ahead and take it. It's the start of man, and it's the closing chapter until he brings it all home. The devil will trick you into thinking if you could just manage to get control, you'll get the rosy picture the world is selling you, and it isn't even real. And neither is control. That's the great lie. That's the great myth the enemy's trying to put forth to you. Look to yourself. You know, sometimes the way the devil gets us to follow him is by getting us to follow ourselves. Now, let me say that again in case you missed it. Sometimes the way the devil gets us, tricks us into following him and not God, is by getting us to follow our own instincts. All those ways we thought we would protect ourselves from pain. All those ways that we would make life an easy path. And in doing so, miss that Jesus is on the bridge that doesn't look so good, waiting for us saying, come on, come follow me. But that's the devil's playground. We are always our biggest idols. Nobody gets in the way of my life more than me. Hands down, you can talk about the enemy, and we will talk about the enemy. But what the enemy does is make me my own worst enemy. Amen? Amen. Come on, I know I'm not the only one. Amen? Amen? Make me my own worst enemy, and this is the human predicament. And from this mundane, existential, if you will, dilemma, the Lord speaks. Proverbs 3, 5 through 6. Trust in the Lord, say this with me, with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. And here's the problem. You got to abandon the way you think you're going to control your destiny, because you'll pick the rosy, grassy field every single time in the flesh. And you're going to look at that bridge, and you're going to see a do not enter sign that the world has sold you, and you're going to think, my understanding is I'm not going there. That can't be where the Lord is. The scripture says he's going to make our path straight. That bridge doesn't even look like it'll hold me. But a broken bridge is straighter than the road that the world is selling you. You might say, well, that's easy for you to say, God. Don't lean on your own standing. Don't resort to your own ways of dealing with things. That's easy for you to say. You didn't walk this. Oh, wait a minute. Jesus. Yes, you did. What'd you say again, Jesus? Whoever loves his life will lose it, but whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternity. Maybe life has to have a different meaning. Maybe life has to start with a different perspective about what it truly is and what the world is selling us that isn't. And for those of you who think the answer to life lies in this world, congratulations. You have heard the words of Mr. Worldly Wiseman, if you know that reference, Pilgrim's Progress. You have heard the words of the Mr. Worldly Wise Man, and you think they're working for you now. Guess what? That grassy, rosy field will cave in before the bridge that Jesus is standing on. Hear it again. That grassy, rosy field that you think is working for you will cave in before the bridge falls that Jesus is standing on. We got to retrain our minds. Something in us has to die. Something has to take that scripture, it's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me, because I've been crucified with him, and realize that the do not enter sign that's sitting on the bridge is the sign the world put, the sign the devil put, but Jesus is on the bridge, and if that's where he is, then let me be crucified with Christ. Amen? Work with me in this. If life has taught me anything, it's be careful of what you put stock in, because you can lose it in the blink of an eye. Your laughter can be turned to sorrow. It doesn't matter if you're on the mountain high or the valley low. Don't put your stock in the rosy picture that the world is selling you, because it isn't real. And everybody knows it. They all know it. I know it. You know it. You know, Jesus says, he says these amazing words, right, in John 16, 33. Put them up there for me, Tiff, if you don't mind. He said, I've said these things to you, right? And he's talked about, you know, you're going to have sorrow. You're going to have tribulation. You're going to have hard times. The path is going to be hard, okay? But we're going to be, the Father and I and the Spirit are going to be with you. And you're going to have everything you need, and it's going to lead to life, right? And he says these things, but watch. I've said that you may have peace. In the world, you will have tribulation, hard times. The path is going to look like a broken bridge. But take heart. I have what? Overcome the world. How does this relate to us? How does Jesus walking out of the empty tomb, overcoming the cross, overcoming death, overcoming the world, how does that change things for us? Well, the answer is in 1 John 5:4. Look. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. When you are born anew from Jesus Christ, you overcome too. You walk out of the tomb with him. But you can't get there from the rosy picture the world is selling you. You got to be willing to take the broken bridge. And I'm worried that the church isn't preaching that. Is today, right now, yeah. I'm worried that the church is selling the same picture that the world is. And just looking to put its own flag in the same land. And I'm afraid it's setting up people. I believe it's setting people up. I don't want it to set my son up or my other son up. To paint a rosy picture that when it falls, we say, well, I guess Jesus was never here with me. And Jesus is still standing on the broken bridge that didn't look cool, that didn't look hip, that didn't have someone in the, you know, doing this in the field. Yeah, I did it. It was nothing cool about that, so we're on point today. I don't do my children any service if I sell them the same picture the world is and just put a different flag on it. Do I? Because that soil isn't ripe for the harvest. You can put a Christian flag in worldly soil, but don't expect the spiritual harvest. You can put a Christian flag in worldly soil, but don't expect the spiritual harvest. Amen? Amen? We overcome because we are born anew, because we have a different perspective. And when you're born anew, you aren't looking for the same picture that the world is. You got different eyes, and you don't see a broken bridge. What you see is an opportunity to overcome. You don't see a broken bridge. You see an opportunity to overcome in Christ's name. And that is the byproduct of rebirth. Learning what's myth and what's real. When you finally learn that true life exists standing on the broken bridge, all of a sudden you're not going to go through hard times and say, God, he doesn't love me. You know what you're going to say? God is my refuge and strength, yes. A very present help in a time of trouble. God is my refuge. I'm worried about what the church is selling. Oh, it's trendy. It's got its skinny jeans and its this and that and it's very hip, and it's very cool, and it's very in. Be careful. Be careful. Because the next generation is going to grow up and want to know what picture they were being sold. And if you tell them that coming to Christ means you're going to get the rosy picture in the world, you are doing them a terrible disservice. I know. I remember when my heart broke from it. And I feel this is where I'm supposed to be with this message for this time. I'm tired of the picture that broke my heart. I'm tired of the picture that broke my heart. Thank you. Amen. I'm ready for the broken bridge as long as Jesus is there. I'm sorry, this has been a lot coming to this point. I apologize. I want you all to know that God loves you. You don't have to look hip and cool for it. I want you to know that the broken bridge doesn't mean you're disfavored by God. I want you to know that world's trying to tell you to be cool and be just right. I don't want to hear that from my church too. I don't want to spend life trying to convince people that life exists in the same soil the world's telling them. In the end, what I feel the most called to preach to you as your pastor is that between the liberation from Egypt and the promised land, the Israelites had to walk many years in a dry and barren land. And somewhere between your salvation, your liberation, and the hope of heaven is going to sometimes feel like a land that is barren. But that's where the miracles come. That's where the bread falls from heaven. That's where the water gushes from a stone. And that's the bridge Jesus is on. I want to make sure that the car that's being sold doesn't look different from the picture. Amen. God, I feel a little overwhelmed today from just what you've been saying and what you've been working and the heart, and I feel very honored to be here in this moment, in this time with these people. To hold the cry, you are our refuge and our strength, very present help in the times of trouble. I love you, God, and these people here, we love you. And Lord Jesus, if you're on the bridge, let us be there too. Let us learn what it means to overcome. In your name we pray. Amen. Please stand and join us.
Weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. Oh, my God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you.
Everybody, if you need prayer, if you like prayer, there's going to be people who love to pray with you down here. If you just need courage to walk the bridge that Jesus is on, if you need healing in your heart, in your life, if you're trying to overcome, Jesus gives us the promise that in Him we overcome. Nothing is too great for Him. Oh, God's people say, amen. Go in peace, everybody. God bless you.